look to the Lord of the world before we look to His word. Loving, gracious Heavenly Father, thank you for your immense love. Thank you for lavishing your loving kindness upon us, Father. Thank you for embracing us with your love and your long suffering. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for cleansing us with your blood, flooding our hearts with your Holy Spirit. And thank you for giving us a new hope. Thank you that, Lord, you have set us on the rock of Christ, the rock of ages that will stand all tests of time. And Lord, we want to bow down and adore you. We want to worship you. Flood our hearts with your Holy Spirit beyond measure. Lord, we want to acknowledge that we are just nothing but clay, but just zero, Lord. Before your almighty power, we are nothing, Lord, yet. Lord, you chose us, you predestined us. Thank you, Jesus. We worship you. Great is your knowledge that is too marvelous for us. Lord, you are too wonderful, too beyond our comprehension. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, Lord, as we are going to sit at your word, sit at your feet to listen to your still small voice. Help us, Father. Minister to our hearts. And Lord, transform us into your likeness. Help us to see the treasures in your word and to become like you. Help each one of us. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen. So, past so many months, we have been looking at the book of Hebrews. We came to the last verses of the book of Hebrews chapter 5 last week, and we even saw first few verses of chapter 6. We were seeing the contrast in the word of the contrast of the milk and solid food in the word of God. You know, Hebrews is a book that speaks much about perfection or maturity. That perfection, that teleotes, that word can be translated as perfection or maturity, completeness, like that. You know, in biology and all, we study the word telomere and all. That telio means to bring to the end, to complete, to become mature. That is that word. So God wants us to become mature. Even Jesus said, be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect in Matthew 5:48 in the Sermon on the Mount. So God wants us to grow spiritually, just like, you know, any father or mother. However uneducated the father or mother themselves are, they want their children to grow up and to study and learn and to stand on their own feet and to help others, and in such a way that even these children would grow up to take care of the parents. Like that, God, our Heavenly Father, is longing that we would become more like Him, because the only good is God Himself. The nearness of God is my good. Psalm 73:28. Psalmist Asaph says there. So the only good that we can have is to be closer and closer to the source of this goodness, that is the God Himself, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Even when Jesus came as a man on this earth, when the rich young ruler came and called Jesus good teacher, Luke 19 we read there, and Jesus is answering, why do you call me good? Only the Father is good. So when he came as a man, he acknowledged that nothing good dwelt in his own flesh, but whatever goodness that you see in me is from the Father above, the Father of all goodness. And the real purpose of our Christian life is actually to become more and more closer and one with this Lord Jesus in our spirit, so that we can reflect more and more of His character. And the more we reflect His character and nature, the more we become like Him, in other words, the more we will have deeper and deeper fellowship with Him. This fellowship with the Lord and reflecting His nature. These are the two sides of the same coin. Eternal life, that word signifies both things, both that attributes. You know, the end of everything is eternal life. When we read in Hebrews 6:1 that it has pressed on to maturity, that maturity means Christ-likeness. That is why we put the topic today as pressing on to the Christ-like maturity along the way of death to self and resurrection in the spirit, death in the self and resurrection in the spirit. So, you know, what is that real maturity that God wants us to have? That Romans chapter 6, we read that verse where that the end of the, you know, the real outcome of whatever is God is trying to do in our life is actually what? Romans chapter 6. Verse 23 is a very famous verse in Romans chapter 6. We often quote that the unbeliever, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our God, Christ Jesus our Lord. But just the previous verse says how we can have more and more of that eternal life. Romans 6:22. But now having been freed from sin and enslaved to God, so the more we become freed from sin, we become enslaved to God, we become the real servants of God. Many a time today that a servant of God has become a misnomer because every Tom, Dick and Harry that comes out of the Bible college, people call servant of God. Many a time they are servants of God, unfortunately. They would be servants of money for their own livelihood. They are just doing a profession. You know, unfortunately, we are not here to condemn or throw stones at anybody, but we need to discern whom we can look up to as really, really a servant of God. Even when we use any word, we have to be careful whether that really means that. You know, sometimes I use the word so-called servants of God because actually sometimes many of these people who call themselves as servants of God and great servants of God or great prophets of God, they on the final day, God might be telling them, I never knew you. We are not here to condemn anybody, but we need to have a discernment. You know, that is what the Hebrews 5 also says, the last part. We need to train our spiritual senses to discern the divine from the soulish, good and bad, good and evil. The good is actually, the ultimate good is God himself, that which is of God, divine. We need to discern that, and that which is evil, that means of human nature, the soulish. That we need to discern. So here, Romans 6:22, having now been freed from sin and enslaved to God, you derive your benefit resulting in sanctification. You know, as a bonus, we get sanctification. We become more and more like Christ. And the outcome of everything of what the Lord is trying to do in our life is eternal life. That eternal life, Jesus himself clearly defined eternal life in John 17:3, eternal life is to know God the Father and the Son whom he has sent. So knowing God, that love relationship and fellowship and that spiritual oneness, spiritual union with the Lord is eternal life. And the more we are one with the Lord, the more we will have the life of God. The eternal life means knowing God and the nature of God, because the word eternal there, even the Greek word that is used over there means actually not just something that doesn't have any end. Many a time when we use the word eternal, we usually think that something that does not have any end, but the word meaning is something that does not have any beginning nor any end. That is that particular word used over there. For eternal life, that is the word that is used over there. I was seeing whether I had written that Greek word somewhere, but anyway, something like I know or something like that. None of us are Greek scholars, but Roman John 17, yeah, I haven't noted down that word. I think I don't know where I have noted down, no problem. But that eternal, that Greek word, that means actually that doesn't have any beginning nor any end. And which is that life which, Adris is typing Aeneos. Okay, thank you, Adris. Blue Letter Bible, if you have that app, or King, Mice Word Bible, in that app, you can see that, yes, Blue Letter Bible, BLB. If you search Blue Letter Bible in the Google App Store, Google Play Store, you can freely download that app and It's very useful to meditate some of these words so that we can get a deeper shades of meaning, so that we can know the word, not to just increase our head knowledge, but to understand the depths of God's word, so that we can surrender to that, to become more like Christ and to become come closer to the Lord. So that Aineos, that word means that which doesn't have any beginning nor any end. And the only life that doesn't have any beginning nor any end is the life of God. And so that life of God, that nature of God, so what God has called us to is this eternal life. That means even when God created Adam and Eve, He created them in His own image. Why? So that Adam and Eve, that man can have fellowship with Him. And the more we have fellowship or oneness with Him, the more we will reflect Him. We will reflect His nature. So, you know, if we also have the same passion in our life will become smoother. Many a time, God has an end in His mind. And we have so many earthly ambitions and goals, and we are dangled with this earthly things. And then we will be confused why God is allowing this and that and the other. But actually, when we can know that God is allowing everything so that He can break our self-will, the more our self-will is broken, the more of the power of the Holy Spirit He can bestow upon us. And the more the power of the Holy Spirit He bestows upon us, we can have more of that oneness with Him in our spirit. And the more we will be able to reflect His nature, His character, His humility, His gentleness, His purity, His selflessness. The more we can speak like Him, the more we can think like Him, the more we can see things from a heavenly standpoint, and the more we will be at rest, you know, the more peace we have in our life, the more rest, the more we are able to love even our enemies, those who oppose us, we are able to love them and forgive them more easily. It won't be a struggle like in the olden days to love people. It becomes a little more of a nature to, you know, to be forgiving and to be loving and to be kind. And, you know, not just because the word of God says to be kind, we are kind, but our, you know, the more our spirit grows in the likeness of Christ, the more we can partake of His divine nature, as 2 Peter 1:4 says. So that is pressing on to that maturity. And for this, actually, the word of God contains, there it says there in verse 12, chapter 5, Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12, milk and solid food. You know, the examples used there are, one is that of food items, milk and solid food. The infants, children, the newborns, they need milk, and then slowly they will be weaned off, and then they will be partaking of solid food more and more. Like that, the milk of the word of God, the solid food of the word of God is there. Then the picture of a building is given over there. That is actually foundation and superstructure. That foundation, chapter 6 verse 1, Hebrews 6 1 says about the not laying again a foundation. So that foundation is actually the milk, and so superstructure is the solid food. And then it says the elementary principles of the oracles of God, verse 12, 5:12. Elementary principles of the oracles of God is the milk and the word of righteousness, that we read in verse 13, accustomed to the word of righteousness, that is the solid food. And the Lord wants, just like a father or mother wants the children to grow up. And suppose there is some, you know, we think, you know, there is some growth deficit, we'll take them to be, take the children to a doctor and see whether my child has got adequate weight and height according to the age. You know, any sensible parent would do that, no? So like that, our Father in heaven is expecting us to grow. And here, as a spiritual father, the Hebrew writer is telling to the Hebrew Christians over there, in verse 11, concerning this Jesus who walked this way of submission and suffering in the flesh and becoming perfect and complete. Verse 9, he says about Jesus who became perfect by obeying, by submitting to the Father. And He became perfect. He learned obedience. He learned submission. We can translate that obedience, the word for obedience, hupako can be translated compliance, submission, obedience. I mean, I would prefer to translate it as submission, because, you know, many a time when we hear the word obedience, we think that we obey of our own, but it is actually submission. Hupako, hupo means by, under, ko means hear, comprehend, understand. So hupako means to comply, to submit, and when we submit only we are able to obey. That is how Jesus obeyed. So he learned submission from the Hebrews 5:8. Although he was a son, he learned submission and obedience from the things in which things which he suffered in the flesh. That suffer, that suffering is not just the physical sufferings. Of course, the physical sufferings were there, but even the suffering in the, even when there was a physical suffering, even when there was temptations, when there were trials or temptations, he suffered in the flesh. He died to the self will, and when there is a death to the self will, there is a suffering in the flesh. We are denying the pleasure of the, we are not indulging in the pleasure of sin, the passing pleasures of sin according to the flesh. So the opposite of pleasure, there is a suffering in the flesh, and there is a death, suffering and death in the flesh. But actually, at the same time, when we die to our self-will, when we humble ourselves, and each every moment in our life, when we humble ourselves and yield to the will of God, yield to the word of God, of course, there is a suffering in our flesh, suffering in our self-will. There is a death to ourself, but there is a empowerment. There is a empowerment by the Holy Spirit, and there is a fullness of joy in the Spirit. There is a suffering in the flesh, and there is fullness of joy through the fullness of the Holy Spirit in the Spirit. You know, we always saw the example of the tabernacle, where the self-will or the flesh or the veil that separated the holy place and the most holy place would be torn. And the more it is torn, the more the power of God through the Holy Spirit would be flooding our spirit in the most holy place. And in the most holy place, in the presence of God, there is fullness of joy, and there are pleasures forevermore, as Psalm 16:11 says. And so this is the way that Jesus walked, the way of suffering in the self, suffering and death to the self, and resurrection. When there is a death, there is a resurrection. You know, it is not like obey, you know, it is like not just Jesus became a man and he obeyed of his own, but he emptied himself and surrendered everything to the Father, and the Father gave him the Spirit beyond measure, as we read in John 3:34. The Holy Spirit was beyond measure upon Jesus, because Jesus humbled beyond measure. The Holy Spirit was beyond measure upon Jesus, and with the power of that Holy Spirit, Jesus obeyed the Father. And even all the ministry that he did, his preaching and the miracles and whatever he did, was always from the Father's initiative. He says in John 5:19 that I can do nothing of my own initiative unless it is something I see my Father doing, and whatever the Father does, I also do in like manner, and greater things than these the Father will show me, that you all may marvel. That is how, like a little child looking up to the daddy and imitating the daddy, like that Jesus lived like a little child on this earth. That's why he says that he who humbles himself like this little child, he will be the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven, and he was the one who humbled himself like the little child the most, and he always depended on the Father, and he became perfect. He became complete. Not that he was imperfect in any area, but he became complete in the area of all the areas of trials and temptations and submission. He obeyed that, and he submitted to that, and he became complete. He became more and more mature, and he, you know, even in Luke 2 we read there that how he grew up in wisdom. Luke chapter 2, where we read about the boy Jesus growing up, beautiful verses there in verse 40. Luke 2:40, the child continued, that is the child Jesus, continued to grow and become strong, increasing in wisdom. You know, if he came with fullness of wisdom as God himself, he didn't have to increase in wisdom. God doesn't have to increase in wisdom, because God is full of wisdom. But he came, he emptied himself and came as a man. So he had to increase in wisdom. By when he submitted to Mary and Joseph, the imperfect parents, imperfect authorities God the Father placed upon him on this earth, you know, he received more of the grace of God, and he received more of the Spirit of wisdom, and he increased in wisdom. The Holy Spirit is a Spirit of wisdom, we read in Isaiah 11:2-3. So the more he humbled himself the more he received the grace, the power of the Holy Spirit, and through the Holy Spirit he received God's wisdom more and more. He increased in wisdom, and the grace of God, the power of God, the power of the Holy Spirit was upon him. And later in the same chapter, the last verses, verse 51 and 52, Luke 2, 51 and 52, he went down with them and came to Nazareth and continued in subjection to them. And his mother treasured all these things in her heart. And Jesus kept increasing in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and men. He always kept increasing in wisdom. He increased in favor with God and with man. And that was how Jesus lived. He became perfect. Although he was a son, he didn't use those attributes, the privileges of the Son of God. But he emptied himself and became like a, that is how he addressed himself, as a son of man. He became a perfect example for us. He became a foreigner for us, as this Hebrews chapter 6 verse 20 says. Jesus has entered as a foreigner for us, one who ran ahead of us this race that is set before us. Hebrews 12:2 says about the race that is set before us. And Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith, and he has ran ahead, and he is at the finishing point, and he is beckoning us and telling, my son, my daughter, you come up higher, you come up higher, you come up forward in this race. Don't be like an infant, continue to be an infant. Of course, we all start as an infant early, but the Lord wants us to mature and be complete. And the only way that is set before us to become perfect is the way of the cross. Jesus says, I am the way. John 14:6, many times we quote that to the unbelievers, but even for believers, he is the way to walk every day. And that way he described us, the narrow way that leads to life, in Matthew 7:13 and 14. Narrow way and broad way are there, and Jesus is that narrow way. And when we walk humbling ourselves and surrendering ourselves before the Lord, we are walking hand in hand with Jesus. We can experience the Lord's presence only in this narrow way, not in the broad way that leads to destruction. In the broad way, there will be many worldly companions. Young people, they will be having many peer pressure, and they want to go along the broad way. You can have the company of many worldly friends in this broad way, but if you want the company of Jesus, the Almighty God, you can have his company only in this narrow way. And he has walked along this way, and now we are called to press on to this maturity, this press on to this Christ-like perfection. And verse 10, Hebrews 5:10, being designated by God as a high priest according to the order of Melchizedek. How Melchizedek was portrayed as a man who obeyed the promptings of the Father and went and met Abraham. So, and concerning this Jesus, verse 11, concerning this Jesus, who became perfect in submission and obedience by suffering in the flesh, we have much to say, but it is very hard to explain because you have become dull of hearing. Not any of you, but Hebrew Christians, because you people are all very eager to hear of the word of the Lord. That's why you all are here. But you know, many times we all, every one of us, can have the danger where we become dull of hearing. We saw that when God says something very clearly in our conscience, and we want to delay that, and we want to, when the Lord wants, convicts us to forgive somebody, or to ask forgiveness from somebody, or to give back something that we have wrongfully taken, knowingly or unknowingly, or whatever, something that nags our conscience, something to, some sin to confess to the Lord, whatever. And if we are hardening ourselves, instead of, when we hear, if you hear the voice of the Lord, do not harden your heart, is what Hebrew writer was telling again and again and again. We saw that in Hebrews 3:8 and 15 and 4:7 says, today if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. But if we harden our hearts, we become dull of hearing. As we saw in the last weeks also, our inner man, when we were born again, our spirit is like a newborn baby. And this newborn baby has got that inner senses, just like we have 5 senses of hearing and seeing and touching and smelling and tasting. The inner man also has got this hearing capacity. And Jesus says, he was ears to hear, let him hear. And even Jesus, the same Jesus, says through John the Apostle to the 7 churches in the Asia Minor in Revelation 2 and 3, he who has ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. Today also the Holy Spirit wants to say to us many things. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So today Jesus wants to tell me many things, and many a time when we don't have time to listen to him, when he have many other priorities, you know, just like a cartoon, many of us would have seen that cartoon where, you know, a sheep is telling, oh, I'm not hearing my shepherd's voice, but the sheep is having earphones and so many gadgets, and the sheep is very engaged with so many other things. The shepherd is calling out from there in loud voice, because, you know, many a time when we use earphones and all, no, when somebody else is calling, we don't hear like that. I'm not saying that we should not use earphones or anything. What I'm saying is that when we have many other priorities in life, and we don't have that sensitive ear in our life, Lord, I want to hear what you want to tell me. Then actually what happens is that we are hardening our hearts, and we have become dull of hearing, and we are not able to grow spiritually. We grow spiritually when we eat of this the word of righteousness that comes from the Father's mouth. You know, Matthew 4:4, Jesus says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that is proceeds from the mouth of God. So in our day-to-day life circumstances, in the trials or temptations, or even when there is apparently no trial or temptation, when the Lord wants to tell us many things, the word of righteousness, we read about this word of righteousness. Righteousness is the righteous requirement of the law, and that was perfectly fulfilled in Jesus Christ. So we can say righteousness is Christ-likeness in simple, understandable terms. So the Lord wants us to make us more Christ-like, and the Lord wants to say, tell many things to us through the word of God, through many circumstances, through even perhaps through some unbelievers, even God can speak to us. And even through many events that happen, even when we read the newspaper, God can speak to our hearts. Even through some songs, some when we meditate the word of God, even through some messages like this and all, God can speak to our hearts. And when we have so many other priorities, and we are not eager to obey him, we won't be able to hear what the Lord is trying to tell our hearts. You know, Jesus says there in John 7:17, it's a very beautiful expression that Jesus used over there, John's Gospel chapter 7 and verse 17. John 7:17, Jesus says, if anyone is willing to do his will, he will know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak from myself. Many a time, why we are not able to know the will of God, and whether somebody is preaching, whether that is of God or whether he is preaching from his own human cleverness and soulish power. Why? Because Jesus says, if anyone is willing to do his will, if we are eager and passionate, Lord, I want to do your will, I want to become like you, I want to obey whatever you have planned for my life. If we have that passion, if anyone is willing, if anyone, you know, we might be younger, we might be advanced in age, we might be male or female, or we might be educated or uneducated, we might have, you know, any caste or creed or color or tongue or whatever differences. If anyone is willing to do his will, not my own will, but his will, he will know of the teaching. He will know, he will understand which is the teaching that leads me to life, or which is the teaching that is just emotionally stimulating me, like so many preaching today, where they are whipping up the emotions, they will be raising up the voice and making the voice tremulous, like Father in heaven, like, you know, some people with some trembling, some Parkinsonism, and sometimes, you know, the tremulous voice and all comes. So like that, this so-called servants of God, not the real servants of God, but they make their voice, they manipulate the emotions of people, and they, so thus says the Lord, somebody has done black magic against you in that part of the house, and so much of, you know, when some even many believers come to me for counseling and all, some things that grieves my heart is that, you know, they gulp whatever the so-called false prophets say about this black magic, and they are afraid of whether those person today also, you know, there was a you know, believer family who came, and you know, the fear of black magic, and because actually this so-called prophets and prophetesses are prophesying about all this. So you will know of the teaching. If you are really passionate to do God's will, you will know that, oh, these are all people who are just making their livelihood out of this so-called prophecies. They are just to get your money. Even you know, sensible unbelievers are able to discern, but unfortunately many believers are not able to discern whether this is of God. So Jesus says, John 7:17, if anyone is willing to do his will, he will know, and he'll know of the teaching. Sometimes there will be some teaching that would be just intellectually stimulating, some clever ideas and bright ideas, just to have a clever explanation, but nothing that is imparting life or making us more, helping us to come closer to the Lord or anything like that. But there will be some clever explanations and intellectual, explanations, and that also, whether it is in the soul realm, there is actually emotions and mind, the intellectual capacity. Some messages would be intellectually stimulating, some messages would be emotionally stirring. But whatever be that, the real spiritual message is actually that will help us to yield our will, that will, emotions and mind are of the part of the soul, the triad, cognitive triangle, and all I was saying, mind, emotions and willpower. So actually, if we are willing to do his will, if we are willing to yield our will and to do his will, then we will know, then we are in the spiritual realm, then we will know of the teaching, whether this is just a intellectually stimulating thing or just a emotionally stirring up thing. The holy place, there was this golden altar symbolizing the willpower, then the mind, the table of showbread, and the emotions, the lampstand. And so whether this is a real word from the Lord, you will be able to know whether it is of God, whether, or Jesus is speaking of from his own will. Jesus didn't speak anything of his own will. He did what the Father told him to say. So that is John 7:17. And coming back to Hebrews, so when we become more and more sensitive in our conscience, and we are more eager to do his will, then we will not be dull of hearing, but rather we'll be more and more spiritually sensitive. And Hebrews 5:12, as a spiritual father, the Hebrew author is telling that Hebrew Christians, by this time you ought to be teachers. So God plans our life in such a way that help my son or daughter to be born again in such and such a year, so that by this time he or she should be mature enough to lead others also to the Lord, and they should be able to help others and bless others. They should be able to they ought to become teaching others. But actually, here the Hebrew Christians, they by that time they ought to be teachers, but you have need again for someone to teach you the elementary principles of the Word of God, and you have come to need milk and not solid food. If a newborn baby, we give some meat or something, the baby can even choke to death. So sometimes actually they won't be able to digest like that. So many of God's people, when they hear about dying to self and receiving the life of Christ and all, they don't understand anything, or they said, oh, this is something too difficult to understand. John 6, when Jesus spoke of eating his flesh and drinking his blood, this is too difficult for us. Many of the disciples said like that, and they left Jesus. We read there in John, eating of his flesh and drinking of his blood also is speaking about doing God's will only. Eating of the flesh basically means partaking of the Word of God, Jesus' flesh. The Word became flesh in Jesus. So eating of his flesh basically means we are yielding ourselves to the Word of God. We are yielding ourselves will to the Word of God. And when we are yielding ourselves will to the Word of God, there is a death, that is drinking his blood. Blood speaks about death. So eating, the symbolism of that is there in the breaking of the bread. But what Jesus basically meant is actually, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you won't have any life. That life comes through the cross only. So that eating the flesh and drinking the blood basically means yielding our self-will to the Word of God, to the will of God, and experiencing the death in ourselves so that we can have the life in our spirit. That is what Jesus says in John 6:50 onwards, unless you eat of my flesh and drink of my blood, you cannot have life in yourself. And when many people heard that, they said this is too difficult teaching, because they were not passionate enough to do God's will. But Peter and the other disciples, although they also wouldn't have understood the real mysteries in the Word of God that time, because they were not baptized with the Holy Spirit that time, but still they had that simple devotion to Christ and they wanted to follow this Savior. And Peter said in John 6:67, Lord, you have the words of eternal life, where else can we go? So that was how the disciples pressed on to follow Jesus despite whatever happened, despite who were followed or who were not followed. So we also, the Lord wants us to, of course, we saw last week, what is this milk? Milk, we saw that chapter 6, verse 1, we read that the foundation is the milk teachings. What is this milky teachings? That is repentance from dead works. That means dead works. We saw that it is apparently good works done with wrong motives, or our self-righteous deeds, which are like filthy rags, as Isaiah 64:6 says. You know, we cannot be saved by our own self-works. We have to repent of them and say that, Lord, you alone can save me. So we repent of our dead works, and even after becoming a believer also, we can do so many things without the prompting or the power of the Lord, and it can end up as good dead works, like as we always say, Romans 11:36, from God, through God, to God. That is the good work. So when it is from man, through man, to the glory of man, Daniel 4:30, that is the dead work. I am not explaining all this because we don't have time. We have explained these kind of things many a time, as you know, those who usually listen. I hope you understand what I am meaning. The repentance from dead work. So then basic repentance, that is milk. And even repentance and faith, that repentance and faith comes together. That is in the foundation. Faith is actually not faith in some promise of God. You know, many a time some people have just, my God shall supply all my needs according to his riches in glory and graces. I believe that only that some selected promises, they have some so-called faith, but they don't have real faith in the God who gave all these promises. But here it says that faith toward God. Of course, we need to have promises in all, faith in all the promises of God. But actually, our real faith is in this God, that faith, that helpless childlike dependence and confidence upon this God. So repentance and faith, and instructions about washings. The NASB is wrong, I should say. It is not washings, it is baptisms, as NKJV rightly translates. That word is baptizo, that means immersion. So two baptisms, water baptism and Holy Spirit baptism. That also, I mean, even the fullness of the Holy Spirit as an initial experience is in the foundation of the Christian life. But if you want to continue and grow in that fullness of the Holy Spirit, that is being led by the Holy Spirit, that is in the superstructure, becoming like Christ. So instructions about washings and laying on of hands. Laying on of hands indicates two things, actually. You know, James 4, we read that, laying on of hands for healing. So healing and learning, then 1 Timothy 4, we read about laying on of hands for the impartation of spiritual gifts. James 5, 14, 15 and all says about, if anybody is sick, call for the elders of the church, they are to pray over him. So that laying on of hands for healing and laying on of hands for the impartation of spiritual gifts. We saw that in 2 Timothy also, that verse that Paul says that, gifts that has been imparted to you by my laying on of hands. 2 Timothy 1, 6, for this reason I remind you to kindle afresh the gift of God which is in you through the laying on of my hands. And also 1 Timothy 4 also, there also we read about this laying on of hands. Verse 14, do not neglect the spiritual gift within you which was bestowed on you through prophetic utterance with the laying on of hands by the presbytery. So that is the laying on of hands for the gifts of the Holy Spirit and for healing. That is of the gifts of the Holy Spirit and all, you know, that is all in the foundation only. Then resurrection of the dead, that there will be a resurrection of the dead, righteous and the unrighteous, and there will be an eternal judgment where we have to stand before the judgment seat of Christ. Well, that is all good teachings, but that is the basic teachings, that are the milk. But the solid food is pressing on to that Christ-like perfection, maturity. Again, verse 13, for everyone who partakes only of milk is not accustomed to this word of righteousness. for he is an infant, but solid food is for the mature who, because of practice, have their senses. We last week also we saw how our spiritual senses, our inner man, our spirit, God has given us a new man or a new spirit when we became born again, and that is like a newborn babe. And then and the more we mature in Christ, more our inner man is growing in Christ-likeness, not our body or our soul. Our body and soul become all the more dependent on the spirit when we become more and more mature. Actually, the paradox in Christian life is that when we are spiritually immature, in our spirit, when we are very immature, in our soul, we will be like mature, like we will be very independent and we know what to do. Our self-will is ruling. But the paradox is that the more we become spiritually mature, in our self-will, we can do nothing of our own initiative. We want to depend on the Lord, all our whatever decisions. Lord, my thoughts and emotions and my decisions, everything is depending on you. You know, we will become more and more dependent on God like a child in our soul realm when we become more and more spiritually mature. In our inner man, in our spirit, we will become more and more like Christ, the maturity of Christ. But in the soul realm, we will be like a weaned child that rests against the mother. My soul is like a weaned child, not my spirit. My soul, Bible says there in Psalm 131, 2 and 3, 1 and 2. My soul is like a weaned child. It means actually you shall find rest for your souls, Jesus says in Matthew 11:29. In our soul realm, our mind and emotions and our decisions, everything would be fully, more and more fully dependent on God, just like a little child is depending on the parents. So like that, we'll be depending on God for whatever, Lord, even to preach the word of God, even to my secular work, even to drive a car, even to cook the food, even to take care of the children, even to do even the mundane works at home. Home, Lord, everything, for everything, even to, walk across the road, even everything, Lord, I need your help. Without your grace, I can do nothing. So like that, we become, the more we are spiritually mature, the more we will be dependent on the Lord. You know, the classic example that Jesus said in, told to Peter in John's Gospel chapter 21, the last chapter of John 21. There, Jesus asking Peter, do you love me more than this? And Peter said, I love you, Lord, you know everything. And he was really broken when Jesus was repeatedly asking him. Jesus gave him three chances to confess him, because he denied him three times also. And after that, John 21:15-17, we read that Jesus asking him, do you love me more than this? Then verse 18 is a very very lovely verse when we understand that maturity in this context. Jesus says in John 21:18, truly, truly, I say to you, when you were younger, that means when you were spiritually younger, you used to gird yourself and walk wherever you wished. You know, you are like a mature man in your soul. You want to do whatever you want. Peter would be, doing so many impulsive things. So many things, even very impulsively, he would be saying, even if everybody denies, I won't deny you. Like that. And all, he was saying so many things very impulsively and all. Gird yourself and walk wherever you wish. But when you grow old, when you grow mature, when you become more and more spiritually mature, what will happen? You'll say that, Lord, I cannot do anything of my own. You will stretch out your hands and someone else will gird you. That is the Holy Spirit. The Lord himself through the Holy Spirit will gird you and bring you where you do not wish to go. Yourself will do not wish to go that way of the cross. But the Holy Spirit will be leading you through the word of through the way of the cross. And that is spiritual maturity. The more we become spiritually mature, the more we will be depending on the Lord for everything. You know, when we are spiritually immature, we think that, I know everything. I know the word of God. I know which verse to quote. I know what to answer. But the more we become spiritually mature, we know that, Lord, you are my wisdom. And Lord, I am so foolish in myself. And Lord, unless you give me your utterance, I cannot do anything, Lord. Even to preach your word or to help somebody or whatever, Lord. Whatever I do of myself would be a dead work. It will be a stench in your nostrils only, Lord. But Lord, if it has to have the aroma of Christ, Lord, you have to do it through me. And Lord, I am surrendering myself as a living sacrifice. So that is the attitude of the mature Christian. The more we mature in Christian life, our soul is like a little child. That means my soul is like a weaned child. That means after the lot of full milk, the child is resting on the mother's bosom. So like that, my soul is like a weaned child. I am feeding on the word of God and I am resting in the Lord. Like John the Apostle rested in the Lord's bosom. We can also have that restful attitude in the Lord. You know, we saw in Hebrews 4 how we need to enter the rest of God. That also is through the word of God, the two-edged sword of the word of God, tearing our self-will. And Lord, we saw that in detail in that portion when we were dealing with that. And the amazing correlation of the word of God, when we see that, really, you know, that really excites us, no? How we'll be challenged. Lord, we are called to become more and more Christ-like. Means the most spiritual person who walked on this earth was Jesus. The most mature man who walked on this earth was Jesus, spiritually mature man. And how did Jesus walk? John 5:19-20, which I just quoted some time back. I can do nothing of myself unless it is something. It is just like a little child saying, unless it is something my daddy does, I cannot do anything of my own. I don't know anything what my father does. I also do anything like that. So like that, really, Jesus lived on the face of this earth. That is the mark of real maturity. When we are immature, we take decisions of our own and we end up in much frustration and foolishness and blunders and so many mistakes we make. But the more we become mature, we become more and more helplessly dependent, just like the branch abiding in the vine. The branch is saying, although I would have borne grapes for so many years, if I am not abiding in the vine, I cannot bear any more fruit. So like that, we'll be so helplessly depending on the Lord. And we need to train. There it says, verse 14, but solid food is for the mature, who because of practice every day we need to walk this way of the cross. If anyone wants to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross once in a year. No, daily. Daily means constantly. Paul explains that in 2 Corinthians 4:10. Constantly delivered over to death for Christ's sake. Always dying, carrying around the dying of Jesus in my body. So that means actually always I consider myself zero before the Lord and surrender myself before the Lord. And so because of practice, that means every time actually, what I have found in my own life is that the more we humble ourselves and acknowledge ourselves nothing before the Lord, the more it becomes a habit for us. You know, it becomes, initially, you know, it will be a little struggle, just like, you know, I've heard Brother Zach's example, like, you know, when for the little children, we have to tell them, brush your teeth, take bath every day, wear clean clothes. But I mean, nobody needs to tell us that we should brush our teeth every day at all. You know, we do that. If you don't brush our teeth only, we feel that, oh, I forgot, I had to, you know, like, you know, that happens. It became a habit for us like that. Even the walking this new and living way also, the more we humble ourselves, initially we tend to stray away and all more and more. But the more we, by practice, that means every day, constantly, continually, the more we by practice, we have our spiritual senses, our spiritual vision, seeing Jesus, seeing the glory of Jesus in the word of God, and hearing the Lord's still small voice, smelling the sweet aroma of Christ, and the sweet aroma of Christ in Lord's presence, as well as in the sweet fellowship with the saints of God. And then tasting the love of God as we meditate the word of the Lord, and sensing the touch of the Lord as we lean on the Lord's bosom. We can, you know, by the fullness of the Holy Spirit, the presence of God becomes so much real to us that we can experience that rest, like a child that leans on the mother's bosom. We can, just like the John the Apostle leaned on the Lord, John 13:23, we read there. Like that, we can also spiritually, we can experience that tactile kind of sensation where we are just leaning on the Lord, that our senses we train to, the more we, and that is actually the way, you know, when we have the spiritual five senses trained. That is the real worship, actually, where we see the glory of the Lord, we hear from the Lord. We are actually becoming one with the Lord. The more we are surrendering ourselves as a living sacrifice before the Lord, the more we will be empowered by the Holy Spirit. And the more we are empowered by the Holy Spirit, we would be in one spirit with the Lord. The God is spirit, and one who worships Him, should worship in spirit and truth. We read, Jesus says that in John 4:24. So, in the spirit only we can become one with the Lord. That means, in our inner man, our soul or in our body, we cannot become one with God. But God is spirit. Just like we already, as we used to say, water and oil cannot be mixed together. Even if we pour and mix it, again the oil would be on the top of the water because of the density difference, as we study in physics. So like that, in our body and soul, we cannot become one with God. Our body and soul can be dependent on God, but we cannot be one with God in the body or soul. But we can become one with God in our spirit. That is what 1 Corinthians 6:17 says, one who joins himself with the Lord is one spirit with him. That means in our spirit, we can become, pneuma, that is the word for spirit in Greek. From that word, pneumonia and all comes. In our pneuma, in our spirit, we can become God's spirit, and our spirit can become one. That's why, we alone can partake of God's nature as human beings. The animals and birds, however clever they might be, they don't have a spirit. They cannot have fellowship with God because they do not have a spirit. They have only soul and body. We have body, soul and spirit. Or in that order, spirit, soul and body, as we read in 1 Thessalonians 5:23. So in our spirit only, we became born again. In our spirit only, we can have fellowship. And in the spirit only, we grow in Christ-likeness. And in the spirit, the more we become one with the Lord, the more we will have, we will be able to see the glory of Jesus in the mirror of the Word of God. Wherever we read the Word of God, we will be seeing Jesus. Like the disciples to the disciples to Emmaus, Jesus was explaining to them from all the scriptures, from Genesis to Malachi. That time only that much scriptures were only written, and from Genesis to Malachi, Jesus was showing about himself, all of the scriptures. How much more in the New Testament, Jesus' glory is there. Even in the Old Testament, Jesus was showing them all the glory of himself. We read that in Luke 24:27, then beginning with Moses and with all the prophets, he explained to them the things concerning himself in all the scriptures. Wherever we see Jesus' glory. That means, glory means actually not any light or pomp or anything, but glory means the nature of Christ, the grace and truth. Jesus was full of grace and truth, John 1:14. The more we will have a revelation of Jesus' humility, Jesus' love, Jesus' gentleness, Jesus' kindness and Jesus' strictness, how Jesus was very passionate against old man-made traditions. Yesterday, in the Malayalam meeting, in the context of Sabbath, and we were telling about, I was slashing against all the man-made traditions, which is not found in the Word of God. And also, that's how Jesus was. When we follow Jesus, not only in the grace aspects, but also in the truth aspects, we'll have a passion and zeal for the Word of God and for His truth. We want to stay uncompromised. We want to stand uncompromisingly, not despising any other person, but we can humbly, graciously take a stand for the Lord and for His word. And that is how in our spirit we can see more of the glory of God. And when we really become one with the Lord in worship, the more we worship the Lord, the more we will be seeing the when people say worship, they mean about going and attending some Sunday church meeting. And so you might be going and attending Sunday church meeting and you may not be worshiping the Lord at all. The real worship is something that happens in the spirit. Jesus says in John 4:23 that one who worships in the Father is seeking for true worshippers who will worship in spirit and truth. God is spirit, and one who worship him must worship in spirit and truth. So that means in the spirit realm only the real worship happens, not in the soul or body realm. Soul and body we use to come to the spirit realm. We use the body, our eyes and ears, to hear the Word of God and see the Word of God, and it goes to the soul realm, to the mind, is instructed with the Word of God, our emotions are stirred up and moved. But when our will is yielded, then we enter the spirit realm where the Holy Spirit floods us, and there we become one with the Lord, and we see more of the glory of the Lord, and we hear more of the Lord's voice. Actually, you know, if we can hear Jesus speaking to us through the Word of God more and more, if we are sensitive every day, if we make it a practice to hear from the Lord, to set apart a time where we want to hear what our Bridegroom, Heavenly Bridegroom, is telling. There in Song of Songs chapter 2 verse 14, there it says, in the cleft of the rock, in the secret pathway of the secret place of the steep pathway, Song of Songs chapter 2, there let me see your form and let me hear your voice. How actually the bride and bridegroom are longing to see one another and to hear their voice. And that should be our, you know, when Jesus becomes our Heavenly Bridegroom and we become one with the Lord. You know, 1 Corinthians 6:17 we read, one who joins himself with the Lord is one spirit with him. That word join, that word kolavo, is that Greek word used over there. And that word join, actually there is the same word that is used in Matthew 19:5, where Jesus says, man shall leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife. That cleave, that the same word is that join or glued or cleave. That means in our spirit we become cleaving, clinging to the Lord. And that is what we read in Song of Songs 2:14. In my, oh my dove, there the bridegroom is telling the bride in the sacred place of the steep pathway, let me see your form, let me hear your voice. You know, we love to have that time with the Lord where we want to hear the Lord speaking to our hearts, where we want to pour out our heart to the Lord. And there, chapter 3, Song of Songs chapter 3 verse 4 says, when I found him, the middle of that verse, when I found him whom my soul loves, I held on to him, I clung on to him and would not let him go. That should be our attitude, where in our spirit we'll be helplessly clinging on to the Lord, we'll be one with the Lord, and we'll be experiencing that tactile touch sensation of the Lord, where we know that the Lord is you know, leading us, taking us by hand. I was always beholding the Lord in my presence, because he is at my right hand, I will not be shaken. Acts 2:25, there is a quotation from Psalm 16:8, referring to Jesus, prophesied by David, quoted by Peter on the day of Pentecost. And we can also have that sense of Jesus' presence with us, and we can smell the aroma of Christ. You know, the aroma of Christ, you know, we cannot explain in words, where, you know, we, that Christ, you know, in whatever suffering or whatever circumstance that we go through, the presence of Jesus will can fill us with the aroma of Christ. And we can also, the more we are attaching ourselves to this Heavenly Bridegroom Jesus, you know, in Jesus is the fullness of aroma. In, if we turn back to Song of Songs chapter 1 verse 3, there it says, your oils, that is the oil of the bridegroom, that is the oil is the Holy Spirit. Your oils have a pleasing fragrance. The Holy Spirit is the one who imparts that heavenly aroma to us, the heavenly aroma of Christ. It's just like a pleasing perfume. And the more the bridegroom's oils have the pleasing fragrance, and if the bride is closer and clinging to the bridegroom, then the bride also will get that fragrance. Your name is like purified oil. You know, when we when, if we are closer to the Lord and if we have that aroma of Christ, then we go and meet others also, even without our opening our mouth, of course there can be a growing aroma of Christ through our lives that can bless other people. You know, like Brother Zach always says this verse in Psalm 23:6, where it says, good like a holy trail that follows us all the days of our life, what all things, goodness and mercy. Psalm 23:6, surely goodness and loving kindness will follow me all the days of my life. If we have this anointing of the aroma of Christ, you know, there verse 5 says, my cup overflows, and my cup is overflowing, and I'm going to one house, and then some of this goodness and loving kindness would be overflowing from me, and will be, you know, making an impact in that house. And when we are going to another shop, and there also we, the cup is overflowing. No? So the overflowing, there will be a trail, just like the water, if it is trickling, it will make a trail. Like that, you know, when the Lord anoints our head with the oil of the Holy Spirit, our cup overflows, and there will be a trail of goodness and loving kindness. That means the nature of Christ, the fragrance of Christ that we will leave behind. I mean, actually, when we really meet real men of God, real women of God, there is a aroma of Christ around them, the pleasant and the happiness and the cheerfulness and how they bless us even without their opening the mouth, how their presence can lift up our spirits, how they smile. Jesus, even Peter looked at Jesus' face and he remembered how he denied 3 times and how Jesus prophesied about that, and he cried bitterly. We read in Luke 22:61-62. And how, we can also have that aroma of Christ more and more in our life, and we can have the taste of the Word of God more and more in our life. And like this, the vision of Christ and seeing the glory of Christ in the Word of God and hearing God and tasting the Word of God, smelling the aroma of Christ and sensing His presence. And then we'll have that discernment about what is of God and what is not of God, what is just soulish and what is so flesh. And so like that, therefore, because the solid food is for the mature, therefore, chapter 6, verse 1, leaving the elementary teaching about the Christ, let us press on to maturity, not laying again a foundation about them. And verse 3, and this we will do if God permits. Of course, sometimes actually when young people grow up and all, we may have to, of course, we need to repeat the foundation also. Even actually many newcomers would be there, when young people grow up to be a knowledgeable age, we need to repeat this foundation as God permits. But let us not finish with that, but let us press on to maturity is what the Lord says. We'll look unto the Lord in prayer. Thank you, loving Father, for this blessed time of fellowship and study of the Word. Your Word is such a treasure. Thank you, Father, for the riches in your Word that you enlighten our eyes to see. Help us, Father, to become more and more Christ-like in our spirit, to become mature like you, more and more dependent on you, Lord Jesus, like a helpless babe. Lord, help us, Father. Help us to depend on you for each and everything, and to receive that word of righteousness that proceeds from your mouth. And Lord, help us to live by that word. Just like you said, I have food that you do not know about, and my food is to do the will of God who sent me. Lord, we want to do your will. We want to hear your word and know your will, and we want to surrender to that in times of our trials and temptations, and at all times, Father. Help us to humble ourselves and to receive from you, and to walk in your ways, and to, Lord, grow in you, Father, to reflect your character, to grow in fellowship with you more and more, and to grow in fellowship with one another who walk in the light. Help each one of us, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you. In Jesus' precious, sweetest name we pray. Amen.